Let's pray. Father, we pray for the word that you're going to speak to us this morning. We want you to speak afresh to us, God. We want you to speak your heart out to us, God. We don't want to listen to what we want to hear. We've come here expecting for a certain things in our hearts, in our minds, in our bodies, but that is not what we want to hear. We want to hear what is in your heart for our lives. We want to hear what is in your mind for us, God, and we surrender to you 100% tonight. We just surrender so that we can hear your voice. We can receive your word together as a church. And in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. So we've been on identity in Christ. How many of us know that if we don't know our true identity in Christ, then we will live a very substandard life. We will live a very haphazard life. We will live a very, very pointless, aimless, meaningless life if we don't have a true understanding of what our identity in Christ is. Amen? So there are three things that defines our identity in Christ. The fact that we are accepted in Christ, we are significant in Christ, and we are secure in Christ. Amen. So we finished the entire series of confessions under us being accepted in Christ. And what are some of them? Let's declare this into the atmosphere. Okay, together. 1, 2, 3. We're going to do this together as a church. Can we do that? 1, 2, 3, go. I am a child of God. I am a friend of God. I am justified by God. I am united with Christ. And I'm bought with a high price. Amen. Now, we saw that I am a part of Christ's body. I am chosen and adopted. I am redeemed and forgiven. I am complete in Christ, and I am welcome into His presence. If you missed any of the sermons, you can go online on the YouTube channel and go back and learn the whole thing. And now we're going to go into the fact that we are secure in Christ. We are protected in Christ. Amen. And last time we learned the first one, I am free from condemnation. Who said that? Dhyan. Good job, Dhyan. Come on, give him a clap. I am free from condemnation. We studied that the last time, right? How when the whole world condemns us, even ourselves, we condemn ourselves. There is what the Bible says is that nobody can condemn those who are in Christ Jesus. Let's read this together. Okay, 1, 2, 3, go. Who then will condemn us? No one, for Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life, and he is sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Amen. This Jesus that we are talking about, he did not just die for us. He was not really raised, but right now he's sitting in a place of authority. And what is he doing there? He is sitting and he is pleading for us. He is not condemning us. There is another voice that condemns us. It's the voice of the enemy. And we reject that voice in our lives. We reject that voice in our businesses. We reject that voice in our families. Every area of our life where we hear a condemning voice, where we hear a voice that is not in alignment with God's word about us, we reject that voice. Amen. We're going into something that I'm very excited to share. This is a scripture that I have held on to as my favorite scripture from my childhood days. Everybody say, I am assured of a good ending. Let's repeat it once again. I am assured of a good ending. Now let's say it together. I am assured of a good ending. Anybody who could tell me the scripture for this? All things work together for the good. Okay, complete the verse. For them who love God and who are called according to His promise. I'm sure nobody will have a trouble in remembering the scripture next Sunday, because this is one of our very well-known scriptures, right? Let's read it out together. Romans chapter 8 and 1 and verse 28. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His promise. Amen. In fact, Romans 8 is my favorite chapter in the whole Bible. And out of Romans 8:28, every time that I go through something which is very challenging, something which is very difficult, I go back to this verse and I confess this verse. I believe in this verse and I know that as long as this verse is true, as long as this verse is a promise in the Bible, I have nothing to worry. Amen. Amen. I still remember the few nights after we had to go through a cesarean for Israel and we were out of the hospital, and Rashmi was in a lot of confusion. She was like, I prayed and I believed and I did everything right, and I don't know why this happened. I don't know why they had to pressurize me into doing a cesarean. I don't know why God would allow this in my life. And then we prayed, and the words God spoke to us was Romans 8:28. God said, hey, you know what? You should know that all things work together. Not individually, but together when they work out for our good and for God's glory. Amen. We're going to dissect this verse and we're going to check out about 7 things that God speaks in this verse. The first thing is this. What does the verse begins with? God causes this thing. It's not something that you can manufacture on your own. It is not something that you push yourself in such a way, that you arrange your circumstances in such a way that it brings, it turns out to be a good thing. It is something that God causes it to be a good thing in your life. If only we can keep our eyes fixed only on Jesus. Only on Jesus. You know, I get text messages and calls every now and then saying, hey, I have been loving everybody. I have been doing everything. I don't know why everybody is treating me bad. I don't know why things are going wrong. This is the one thing that I tell them. Hey, you know what? Don't look to people. There is one person who will never let you down. And who is that? That is Jesus. That is God. That is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. If you can fix your eyes on Him and say, God, I know that this is how people treat me, but my eyes are always going to be fixed on You. He will never, 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 never let you down. Amen. Not in your entire life, not in the entire eternity. God cannot let you down, no matter what happens. Amen. So that also brings me to this point where I have to begin to check my circumstances and tell myself, hey, you know what? God causes this to turn out to be good. If God can cause something that is really bad and ugly and something that is not so great to be shared as testimony in church to turn out to be a testimony, to turn out to be for my good, then I better trust in this God. Amen. The next thing that we read in this verse is that it says everything. Okay? It doesn't say just the good things. It doesn't say only the spiritual thing. All the spiritual things in your life, they work out for good. It doesn't say all the things that you do right, that is what works out for God's good. It includes everything. You know what is included under everything? All the nonsense talk you have ever made in your life. You know those things that we don't want to share on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. You know those moments in our life. You know, you and I know this, right? Like this morning, you know, there's something called as Instagram story that has come up, and I've been so addicted to Instagram story. And this morning I woke up at I think 5, and Rashmi joined me at around 6:45, 7, and as soon as she joined me, I'm like, hey, you look beautiful, let me put it up on Instagram story. And she's like, are you serious? Look at my face, this is not Instagram worthy. Morning when you wake up, you don't want to put that picture up on Instagram. Am I right? All the sisters, you understand what I'm... Brothers, we look the same, morning, night, and noon. Yesterday, today, and forever. There is no change. You know, that actually works for our benefit, you know. But you know, the Bible says everything. when it is put together, even those moments that are not worth sharing, those moments that are not worth telling anybody about. I mean, my best testimonies are stuff that I cannot share in public. But I'm telling you, I'm so thankful for those moments. I'm so thankful for what God did in my brokenness, in my weaknesses. And the Bible says everything, you know, everything. Don't ever sit regretting your past. Don't ever sit regretting your circumstances. Because if that one tiny little thing in your past wouldn't have happened, then you wouldn't have been here today. Because God works everything. Amen? So don't look down on yourself. Don't look down on what happens. And this is what the Bible says. This is what God does. He makes everything work together. What does it mean? It means that everything that happens in your life, it gives you one or the other lesson. It teaches you something. It gives you an insight on how to live today, on what to do, what not to do. It works. It's working towards a purpose. You know, when we go through, when we have counseling sessions and then when people come up to us and they share things and we are like, hey, guess what? I went through the exact same thing. And that's when we realize that, hey, when I was going through this about 10, 15, 20 years back, what God was doing was God was making it work together for me in such a way that I will be able to counsel somebody else. It was not a wasted experience. It was something that God was trying to work together so that it will help somebody else. Amen. We have to be people who will understand that none of your life situations are taken just one at a time. Like you might say, hey, this one thing is going right, but everything else is going crazy. Everything else is falling apart. But guess what? Doesn't matter how it looks to you today. The Bible says all things. What does it do? What does it do? Work together on its own. On its own. But who causes it to happen? God causes it to happen. Amen. And this is the part that I enjoy, that I really, really enjoy. What does it say? It works together for the, amen. You know, at times it's very difficult to believe this. It's very difficult to trust this because when circumstances go crazy, you're like, can anything good come out of this situation? Can anything good come out of my sickness? Can anything good come out of such ugly stories? Can anything good come out of this? But what does the Bible say? He knows how to work together, work it all together for the good. I mean, you have to imagine this God, this Jesus, as this potter who sits on the wheel. And, you know, when dirt or mud or, you know, then you put your hand inside. How many of you guys enjoy walking barefoot during rainy season? Nobody enjoys, especially if you've been back from Mumbai, like I was just last 1 week, where I mean, the one thing I don't want to enjoy in Mumbai is the roads when it rains. It goes messy. That is, it's so sticky. It becomes so dirty. I mean, like, I'm like, hey, I cannot. It sticks to your pants. It's all over your shoes. You walk into a house, it's all there. It gets messy. Guess what God takes? God takes that dirt. God puts his hand into that dirt. God doesn't just speak it out. You know, God is not standing up in heaven and saying, hey, everything fall into place. That's not what God says. God says he actually puts his hands into your life. Your life in his hands and he works it together. He's doing something. Sometimes when we resist it, you're like, God is like, hey, this didn't come out to be as good as I planned it to be. Let me break this and let me make it afresh. Let me make it new again. And what does he make in the end? He makes something that is good. Everybody say good. Good. Amen. And that is not the end. The Bible says that he makes it work together for the good of those who Those who? Let me hear a loud amen from people who really love God in this place. Yeah. Amen. That was loud. That. Thank you. It is not for everybody. No promises in the Bible is unconditional. Did you know that? There is no promise in the Bible that says, hey, you live however you want to live. You do whatever you want to do. You be whatever you want to be. And God will forgive you. God will take you to heaven. God will do. No promise in the Bible is unconditional. God's love for you is unconditional. But God's forgiveness is not unconditional. It depends on if you are willing to receive it or not. Even the same way, this promise is not unconditional. It is for those who love God. As simple as that. How easy is it to love God? In a sense, it is easy, and in a sense, it is the most challenging thing to do in our life. Because the Bible says, if you do not love me more than your father, more than your brother, more than your spouse, more than your children, more than your property, more than your iPhone, more than your car, more than your education, then you are not worthy of me. You know, Jesus uses very strong words when he says that, hey, if you don't sacrifice these things when in your pursuit of love for me, then it's a challenge. That's not the end. And he goes on to say, hey, and those who are called, you know, the Bible says many are called, but few are chosen. But we belong to those who are called, who are chosen, you know. This promise is not necessarily true for unbelievers. That is one reason why when people come to Jesus, we tell them, hey, you know what? As of now, everything in your life is turning around. All of universe is turning around because God has started working it all together for your good. Amen. As of now, yeah, that this promise is specifically for people who have put their faith, their trust in Jesus, those who are called by God, those who are called to be set apart. Amen. So if you have not put your faith in Jesus yet, today is the day for you to do that so that you can receive this promise over your life. Amen. And this is his promise. This is not a man-made promise. This is not a promise made by Apostle Paul. This is not a promise that I am telling you today. This is a promise made by God. What does he promise? That everything will work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his promise. Can we confess that verse together? Once again, this time, really meaning every word that we speak. Okay? And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purposes for them. Amen? Amen. I'll tell you the story of this one guy in the Bible. It's very crazy what God let him go through. You know, sometimes we think that what we have experienced in life is really bad, that what we have gone through in life is terrible. But here is a story of somebody who went through a crazy time during his lifetime. And I'm speaking about this guy called Job. How many of you know Job? How do you know him? He lived like thousands of years before you. There's no way you could have known him. You've read about him, right? Yeah, that's great. Just kidding. Job chapter 1 verse 1. There once was a man named Job who lived in the land of Uz. He was a blameless man. This guy was not a bad guy. He was a blameless man. A man of complete integrity. He feared God and stayed away from evil. Now, I'm assuming that this is not Job writing his own book and in his own goodness, but you know, let's read verse 8. It says in verse 8, this is God testifying about him. You know, what did God tell Satan? Have you noticed my servant Job? He's the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God and stays away from evil. This is God testifying about Job. I mean, is there anybody in this place who can like be like 10% more than Job? I'm sure that there are people in this place like that. But this is what God says. God says, hey, this is a man of complete integrity. And guess what Satan said? You know what? Yes, that is true. That this guy is a man of complete integrity. But the reason he's like that is because you have blessed him. You know, this guy does not love you unconditionally. You know, this guy is very mean. If you bless him, he will be happy. If you don't bless him, he will be upset with you. He will curse you. He will blame you. He will leave you. And God said, okay, let's put this to test. This is what you're saying. Now you have to understand this. Job didn't know any of this. Job is this pavam Christian living a normal life, very happy with what God has done for him. He has no idea about what is happening in heaven, the conversation that is happening in heaven. And you have to know that every circumstance that happens in your life, there is a spiritual reality to it which you and I are not understanding, which you and I don't see immediately. When something goes crazy in our life, when there is an accident, when there is a financial problem, when there is things that people are saying about you, when there are crazy things that comes against you, you think that, oh man, all these people, they hate me. What we don't realize is that there is a spiritual world outside of those people that are in conversation about these minute details of things that are happening in your life. Amen. And this is what the Bible says. God said to Satan, all right, you may test him. Do you know that at times God says all right to the devil? You know, and this is the thing. God wouldn't dare to put any Tom, Dick and Harry for test, because they know that they're going to fail the test. God only puts his finest men out there for a battle. Do you get what I mean? Like if India has to go for a full-fledged war against any country, who are the ones that we will send in the front? The weakest ones? No, our finest warriors, our finest battalions, our finest pilots, they are the ones that we will send in front, and because they are the ones who can do the best job for us, right? So when testings come your way, don't think that, hey, you've been a really bad person. Just believe that God thinks that you are a fine man. That God thinks that you're a fine woman, and that you're willing, that you're capable to go through a testing time and come out of it strong. Amen. God believed in Job. Job didn't believe in himself, but God believed in Job. If you read through the book of Job, you will see Job saying this again and again. Oh, I might give up any point of time. But you know what God said? God said, hey, you want to test this guy? You can test him. I know this guy's heart. I know this guy's life. He's not going to give up on me. Amen. And guess what? Guess, you know the story, right? He, how everything goes crazy. The devil steals his property. You know, this is the funny thing. You know, one of the verses in chapter 1, the Bible says that his servants came to him and he said that God sent fire from heaven and all your property is gone. But did God send or did the devil do it? Are you sure? God loved it, but who actually did it? The devil did it. You know, sometimes we attribute what God has allowed in our lives directly to God, which is actually not true. Sometimes it's not, you know, we can never say that there is anything that God would do. Let's say sickness for that matter. Let's say poverty. Let's say, any trouble that you go through, don't ever be under the impression that it is God who has given you those troubles. But it is the devil who is itching to do it. And the devil cannot do it till he has permission from God. And God will not give him permission until he knows that you have the capacity to go through it and glorify God's name. Amen. And this is what the Bible says. Not only did his property get lost. Not only did his business and everything get lost. Not only did his children get lost. You know, his own wife. You know, this is the funny thing. The devil kept the wife alive. The devil did not kill the wife. The devil knew that, hey, keeping her alive may be more useful for me. His wife said to him, what did his wife say to him? She says, are you still trying to maintain your integrity? Why don't you just curse God and die? Man, that is painful to come from somebody that you love, right? To say that, hey, my somebody who's supposed to stand with me through rich or through poor, through sickness or in health. I'm sure she came back because it speaks about the later part of it where they had more children. But this is what the Bible says. It says his own wife turned against him. I mean, can you imagine how miserable, how difficult that is? I mean, I'm just coming from a country where multiple marriages are allowed, but here in India it is not. So, you know, it's a challenge, right? Not the fact that multiple marriages are not allowed, but the fact that, you know, somebody that you loved, somebody that you trusted so much, they come to you and say, hey, you know what, I'm not for what you're going through right now. You're all on your own right now. And guess what happens? He speaks of this. Job chapter 3:26. He says, what we are going to do is we're going to inspect what is happening in his heart and in his life. Okay? This is what the Bible says. I have... Who is speaking? Job is speaking. He says, I have no peace, no quietness. I have no rest. Only trouble comes again and again. I mean, I want you to visualize this. Just to avoid the graphic details, I didn't share this, but this guy, his entire body is rotting away. Can you imagine? His flesh is rotting away right in front of him. That's irky. I mean, that's why his wife said, why don't you just die? Why don't you just curse God who let this happen in your life and die? You know, and you know, at one point Job, you know, probably, you know, when you're lonely, you start thinking of what your wife told you, and this is what happened to Job also, and see what he starts saying. Oh, that I might have one request that God would grant my desire. He's praying to God. And guess what he's praying? He's praying, I wish he would crush me. I wish he would reach out his hand and... Here he's talking suicidal stuff. He's lost his peace. He's lost his life. He's lost probably his discontent in his heart. He's gone through such a crazy thing. You know, for us, sometimes, you know, one thing might go wrong or two things might go wrong. This guy is somebody who has, everything has gone wrong. Like, and it's not something that seems to be, you know, something that can be turned around. Like, if you lost one subject in your engineering, you can probably write it again in the next semester. But if you've lost everything, one after the other, I mean, this guy is in a place where he doesn't have any peace. And he's saying, God, I have one prayer request. You know, he would have gone to church and everybody is praying for blessing and healing. And it's like, Lord, I want to die. Will you please honor my request? I just want you to just crush me. I want you to reach out and kill me with your hand. And that's definitely not a good prayer request. Right? And he goes on to say, he says, God is not a mortal like me. Also, I cannot argue with him or take him to trial. This guy, he's so upset with God at this point. You know, and he's saying, hey, I want to take God to court. Like, who has the audacity to say that I want to take God to court? Now check this out. This guy had a very close relationship with God. You know, so he had genuine reasons to be upset. Because that he lived in a time when Romans 8:28 was not written. He lived in a time when there was no Bible. He lived in a time when there was no prophets or priests around him to encourage him. He lived in a time when there was no Bangalore revival center that he could go to on Sunday mornings. He lived in a time when there was no WhatsApp forwards coming to his phone. Do you know that some people, the sole inspiration for them is WhatsApp forwards, because, you know, they sleep through the sermon on Sundays, they don't read their Bibles, and their the only source of inspiration is when that verse comes on WhatsApp. They're like, oh man, this is the verse. And here is Job saying, God, I'm so mad, I'm so upset. I want you to take you to trial. And he goes on to, very prophetically, he says this, okay? He says, if only there were a mediator between us, somebody who can bring us together. Who is he talking about? Is there any mediator between God and man? Yes or no? What is his name? He's very prophetically speaking. He's saying, God, you are out there. You are so unapproachable. If only there was a mediator between God and me. And that is what Jesus did for us. Jesus released Romans 8:28 by dying on the cross for us, by taking our pain, our shame, our sicknesses, everything on the cross. This verse was not necessarily true for Old Testament folks. You know, though God is still the same yesterday, today, and forever, you know, they couldn't claim this verse. But because we have Jesus, through whom we have access to God, you know, today you don't have to stand up here and say, oh, God is out there, I cannot have a conversation with him. Today the Bible says Jesus is sitting on the right hand of the Father, and he is pleading for us. He's interceding for us. He's fighting our case with the Father. Amen?
Amen.
And he goes on to say in 23 verse 8, says, I go east, but he is not there. I go west, but I cannot find him. And I do not see him in the north, for he is hidden. I look to the south, but he is concealed. But this is what the Bible says. It says, this is Job confessing in faith. He's saying, but he knows where I am going. And when he tests me, I will come out as pure as gold. I mean, even going through all of these things that he was going through, Job knew that that was not the ending. Job knew that my story might look very dramatic, very, very bad, very disturbing to many people, but that is not the ending, because when he tests me, I will come out as pure as gold. I mean, how many of us would have the guts to tell God this? You know, God, I don't care what you allow me to go through. I don't care what is this everything that I have to go through. I don't care what is this everything that you will allow the devil to put across my way. But I will go through it believing that you can bring me out as pure as gold. Amen? A gold is purified by? Right? Not by keeping in the fridge. Not by decorating it, not by celebrating it. It is purified by fire. If God had to celebrate you, the only thing that will happen is your head weight will increase and you will start bloating up like a balloon and you will go up in the air. That is why sometimes God allows you to go through fire. Can I tell you something, church? It is good for us. Everybody say, it's good for me. So I'm not saying that you cannot pray that God wouldn't heal you. I'm not saying that you shouldn't pray that God would take away that financial trouble. I'm not saying that you shouldn't ask God to change your circumstance. You have all the right to pray that prayer. You have all the promises in the scripture to pray those prayers. But what I'm saying is, hey, when God doesn't answer those prayers, you can go back to God and say, God, you know where I am going. When you test me, you can find me come out as pure as gold. Can I tell you something? God's intention is for you to be a pure vessel, not a decorative vessel, not a celebrated vessel. God's intention is that when you get to heaven, you better be something that will go along with the gold in heaven. The gold in heaven is not adulterated gold. It's not mixed with other metals. The gold in heaven is pure. Amen? That is, if anyone in this place is as pure as that, you will not be here this morning. God would snatch you away into eternity. And the reason why we are still here is because God wants to, you know, do a cleansing process. God wants to purify some things in our life. And sometimes God will allow the devil to do some things in our life. But the Bible says, God causes everything to work together for my good. Amen. Called according to his promises. And we know the story of Job. The Bible says, you know, he starts asking God questions. He starts speaking to God. And God replies finally. And the Lord challenges Job. And the Lord answered Job from the whirlwind. It's a beautiful book to read if you want to enjoy reading. And you want to become a little philosopher. Go and read Job. You'll really enjoy reading the book of Job. It says in verse 2, this is God speaking. Who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorant words? Now, Job was ignorant because he did not have a Bible. He did not have YouTube sermons. He did not have anything that we have access to today. He did not have Jesus to show him the heart of the Father. You know, today we have seen Jesus and we know that he is good. And because we have seen Jesus and we have seen that Jesus is good, we have seen and known that God is good. The Father is good. But he was ignorant. He did not have access to God. He did not have access to the heart of God. And that is why he spoke a lot of ignorant words from chapter 2 onwards all the way to chapter 37. And then God starts speaking to him, convicting him and telling him, hey, you know what? I am more wise than you are. I am in control of the whole universe. You know, and you know, what are the questions that God asked him? Hey, can you count how many stars are in the sky? Can you measure or the ends of the earth? Who are you talking to? I am this God who is sitting on the circle of the earth, who is far above. I created the whole seen universe in place. You don't even understand how this universe works. You know, science is still trying to figure out how this universe works. This is the seen, natural, physical universe. And God's asking him, hey, you don't understand the seen, natural things, which are simple, which I created with this much wisdom. How will you understand what is happening in the unseen world, the unseen realm? Do you remember what happened in chapter 1? What happened in heaven? That there is an unseen reality to what was happening beyond his circumstances. Many times it's very easy for us to see the physical circumstances and get sorrowful, get discouraged, and think that, man, everything is going bad for me. Everything is going crazy. And that is the time when we have to tell God, God, I only see the natural. There is something beyond this natural. I want to see the spiritual world. I want to have a glimpse of your greatness. That is what God did for Job. God started giving him a glimpse of his greatness. And listen to Job's reply. And Job replied and he said, I had only heard about you before, God. And now I have seen you with my own eyes. I had only hearsay knowledge about you. But today I have seen you with my own eyes. Now, let me relate a scripture from Matthew chapter 5. What does the Bible say? I think it's verse 8. It says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall hear God or see God. For they shall see God, right? Now, what happens when you go through fire? What did Job say? That you will find me? as pure as gold. Amen. So what is God, what is the ultimate reality of God letting you go through fire? It is so that your heart will become so pure, that your intentions, your motives behind following God will become so pure that you can have a real encounter with Him. You know, if we come to God for property, for money, for all these externals, will God give us? Yes, God will give us, but we will not be able to go through the fire. We will not be able to go through the fire and still remain faithful to God like Job was, because his heart was after God. His heart was not after the money. His heart was not after these external things. And because his heart was not after these external things, you know, when he came out of the fire like gold, and his heart was pure, it was tested to be pure. This is what the Bible says. This is what Job says. He says, I have not just heard you, but today I have seen you with my own eyes. Can you imagine that encounter that Job would have with God, who dwells in unapproachable light? I believe that whoever appeared to Job will be Jesus, should have to be Jesus, because it speaks about the fact that nobody can see God the Father. Anybody who sees him will die. Like it's crazy, unapproachable light. He dwells in unapproachable light. And all the fullness of God lives in Jesus. And you would see that all the encounters that men of God have had in the Old Testament, most of them were Jesus. Jesus appeared to Joshua. Jesus appeared to Moses. Jesus appeared to, so many people in the Old Testament. Daniel, if you read Daniel's description of God, that is exactly the same description that John is writing in the book of Revelation about Jesus. Like every time somebody had an encounter with God in the Old Testament, that was Jesus. And here is Job saying, I have not only heard about you, now I have seen you with my own eyes. Can you go to your circumstances and tell yourself, you know, I know that this circumstance looks really bad. I know that this is so heavy to bear this. But I know that at the end of this, I will see God. I will have an encounter with God. I will have, I'll see God in a way that I have never experienced or seen Him before. If you can tell yourself that, if you can say that, hey, my tomorrow is anytime going to be better than my today, because God causes everything to work together for my good. And that is the story of Job. It says, when Job prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes. In fact, the Lord gave him twice as much as before. After he reached heaven, here on the earth. I like that song, the song that we sing, the African song that we sing. What is it? Everything is? Double, double. Amen. And that was the story of Job. Everything multiplied, except the wife, of course. He didn't get two wives instead of one. But everything else, it doubled. After he went through the, you know, it says that the number of camels that he had multiplied, the number of oxen, everything, that was double of what he lost. And he had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and out of the first 10 had already died and gone to heaven, and now he had another 10. So in total he had 20 children to look forward to enjoying fellowship with in heaven. This is the story of Job, a man who persisted, a man who stayed still through the trials. Let me tell you what he did. Job chapter 1 verse 20. It says, he stood up. What did he do? When he heard these stories, he stood up. He tore his robe in grief. That was a common expression of grief in the Old Testament. Today we throw our phones, right? Or what do you do today? Today we, you know, there are people who break their bangles. Sorry? We tweet about it. Okay, I'm sorry for whoever is going to cause him sorrow. He'll only tweet about it. But you know, he tore his robe in grief. You can understand that this was very painful for him. This is very children that we are talking about. And then he shaved his head. Today it's style statement. Back then it was symbol of grief. And he fell to the ground to mourn, to cry, to be bitter, to not forgive God. What did he do? He fell to the ground to worship. Now you know why God was proud of this guy. This guy was a worshiper, not when he had blessing. This guy was a worshiper even when everything was lost. God, the devil is not after your property. The devil is not after your business. The devil is after your worship. If he can get the worship that you give to God, if he can get the relationship that you have with God, and the devil is successful. If he can destroy that relationship, then he is happy, he is successful. And he said in verse 21, he said, you know what, he sent one of the most profound statements ever written in the scripture. He said, I came naked from my mother's womb and I will be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had and the Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord. This is very profound for him to have said this at that time and saying, hey, I came here naked and I'm going to go back naked. No point in crying and weeping and spending my time about all these things. There is one thing which is an eternal investment. It is my worship. Can you imagine people who worship at funerals? This is a massive funeral here. 10 people dead in this house. And I'm sure there will be other servants and all those other people who were feasting along with them, who were helping the feast, who would have died along with the 10 children. This is a massive funeral. And Job has the audacity to have a worship concert right in the middle of the funeral. And it says in verse 22, in all of this, read it with me, okay? In all of this, this guy did not have the Bible. This guy did not have a pastor. This guy did not have good friends. His friends had twisted theology about God. They had absolute no understanding about who God is. The Bible says God was upset with their understanding of. This is the guy that we are talking about. And the Bible says in all of this, Job did not sin by blaming God. The first thing that we do is blame God. The first thing, and I mean, when things go right, the first thing that we do is we call that person who brought us that business contact, and we thank him. And we, when something goes bad, the first thing that we do is, God caused this to happen. Friends are good. People are good, but God caused this to happen. And we always end up blaming God. And that is why God was so proud about Job. What did God say? In all of this, Job did not sin by blaming God. He goes on to say, God might even kill me, but I have no other hope but God. And the translation says, even if he will slay me, I will still wait on him. I will still hope on him. I will still trust in him. Do you have the audacity to say that? I mean, we don't even say, I mean, it's very risky to say that in our world to each other, but do we have the audacity, the kind of trust and faith in God to say, God, even if you kill me, I will have no other hope but you. In verse 25 of chapter 19, he says, but as for me, I know that my Redeemer lives and he will stand upon the earth at last. And after my body has decayed, yet in my body, I will, this guy is talking about resurrection. He's saying that I will see God in my body, even after my body. You know, right now his body is rotting away, his body is decaying. He's saying, and after my body has decayed, yet in my body, he had a hope of a resurrection. And he says, in my body, I will see God. I will see him for myself. Yes, I will see him with my own eyes. You know, did you understand the hope that he had through the suffering? This is the time when the suffering had not finished. What did he say in chapter 42? He says, I had only heard about him, but now I have seen you. That was his hope through the entire suffering. It's like, it doesn't matter even if I have to die. After dying, during the resurrection, I will see him. And this guy was a genuine worshiper of God. This guy was genuinely after the heart of God. He was not asking questions about, you know, God, do you know how much loss, how much time it took me to build this business, what all my children's dreams and ambitions were. None of those things. His only thing is, God, I want to have a word from you. I want to be able to see you. I want to be able to worship you through this crazy time. James speaks about the book of Job. He speaks about Job and he says, we give great honor to those who endure suffering. Read it with me. For instance, you know about Job, a man of great endurance. You can see how the Lord was kind to him at the end. For the Lord is full of tenderness and mercy. What is our title this morning? That I am assured of a good ending. The Lord was kind to him at the end. I have a good news for you. Whatever you are going through right now, that is not the end. It might be chapter 1, it might be chapter 2, it might be chapter 3, but you have not reached chapter 42. God restored Job's fortune only in chapter 42. You've not seen what is happening in chapter 1 of your life. You're probably between chapter 2 to chapter 41, where you're wrestling with God, you're fighting with God, you're asking answers, you're trusting, hoping, worshiping, sometimes making mistakes. Even with Job, he made a lot of mistakes in what he said to God. God was upset that he's speaking so ignorantly. And yet in the whole thing, he said, he kept believing, he kept trusting that I will see God, that I will have a relationship with God, that I will have an experience with God. Through the whole time, he kept his eyes on Jesus. And I pray and I hope that we will do that. That somebody, when they write a story about us, that they will say, hey, we give great honor to that sister, to that brother who endured great patience. And at the end, God was kind to that man. And another encouragement in the Bible, it is Philippians chapter 4 verse 4. It's not just saying that we go through this this time with, you know, without crying. What is it saying? You know, the Bible is at times a little crazy. You know, it says, instead of slapping the other guy, you turn your cheek and let the other guy slap you once again. And here it says, when you go through times like this, what should you do? You should rejoice. Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again. Rejoice. It's a commandment from God to you. Always, in every circumstances, through this everything that God is working out in your life, you do not have a reason to grumble today. You do not have a reason to murmur today. The one sin that the Israelites did again and again against God was that they started murmuring in the wilderness. If we could just come to God and say, God, I don't care what I go through. I am going to rejoice in my situations. Amen. Let me hear a sound of joy in this house. Yeah. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles come, read it with me. Come on. Dear brothers and sisters, when trouble come your way, consider it an opportunity for. We consider it an opportunity to blame God, to blame each other. But what God's word says is we consider it an opportunity for great joy. Can you tell this to your neighbor? If it's a brother, brother. If it's a sister, then sister. Tell them, hey, dear brother, when things go crazy in your life, when things go crazy in your life, consider it an opportunity for great joy. Amen. Tell somebody that it is good that something like this happens, because you have a reason to rejoice. It's not only the promotions and the blessings and the good things in your life that you have to celebrate. You have to celebrate troubles now. Why? Because the Bible says all things work together for my good and for God's glory. Amen?
Amen.
And in verse 3 it says, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. When you're sitting in a lifestyle which is comfortable, perfect, nice, your endurance doesn't grow. But what is the point of your endurance growing? He goes on to explain. He says, so let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, somebody say fully developed, you will be, is it possible? Bible says you will be perfect and complete and needing nothing. We all remember what Job said in 23:5, right? He says, but you know where I am going and you see me, and when you have tested me, I will come out as pure as gold. That is God's intention of letting you go through certain circumstances, situations, and you have to know that, hey, even in the whole thing, I am secure. Why? Because God causes every one of these situations to work together for my good. Here is a verse which will encourage you. It says, yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory that He will reveal to us later. What you're going through right now, or what you might go through at the end of the day, what you might go through when you're facing life, is nothing compared to the glory that He will reveal to us. Somebody said an amen.
Amen.
What should be our response when we are going through something like this? Four things. We have to love God. We have to trust His promise. We have to worship Him unconditionally. We have to pray for each other. Where did I get this from? Job prayed for it. When Job prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes. He was not like, hey, everything is going bad in my life. What will I do for you, man? How will I pray for you, man? Why will I pray for you? I'll let God bless me first. Then I will pray for your blessing. No, he was like, doesn't matter what happens in my life. I'm going to be unselfish and I'm going to invest into your life. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to help you in your area of need. I know things are not looking great for me, but I'm going to pray for each other. And the last but not the least, the Bible says, rejoice. Amen. Consider it an opportunity for great joy. The Bible says, consider it an opportunity for great celebration when troubles come your way. When your manager decides to give you a demotion in your work, when your manager decides to fire you from work, you know what? You should call for a house church in your place and order for biryani, because that's a reason for celebration. Amen. Why? Because God is trying to teach you, take you towards perfection. God is trying to take you towards something good. And God causes. Who knows this? Does BRC know this thing? Let's declare this out. Romans 8:28. This is going to be our scripture for memory for this verse, for this week. For we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purposes for them. Is there anybody in this place like that? I want you to make a point, or come to a point of absolute surrender and complete trust of His will, His plan in your life. But we're going to tell Him, Lord, we love You. Lord, we trust Your promises. Lord, we want to worship You unconditionally. Lord, we want to pray for one another. We want to manifest joy in this house. We want to manifest joy always. Your word encourages us to be in joy all the time. And today we want to manifest that joy, God.